Yeah, I think it's recording. Okay. So, I don't know if you got the email for the Google Drive. So, last things first, it will be
Yes,
like.
we did get it.
Yes, Deep Learning Lectures. Okay. So, to make these things work properly, I will show you. I don't know if it's you have like a Google Drive account, you have all of this, and. It works as it is. We have like these Jupyter notebooks here, and you can open on the Google Colab. So to open a Google Colab, you click with the right button of the mouse, and you should have this kind of option here, open with a Google Collaborator. If you don't have this option, you go here on Connect with More Apps, this, and okay, and look for collaboratory. Look for this, and it will give you this option, and you can install. And after install, you have like the option to open the collaboratory. Cool. But before you open anything of this, I would suggest like go in your Google Drive, and go in Share with Me. Okay, in shared with me, you have all the folders that are shared, that are this, and one of these folders should be the lecture one, like the deep learning lectures. And what you have to do, you just have like right click with the folder that is being shared, and you click this here, add shortcode to drive. So by this way, you have like this shared folder on your Google Drive. And you don't need to worry about change paths or anything like this. The paths that are set on the Jupyter notebooks, they will be the same for me, for you, for anyone. So you have like not to worry this. But it will only work if you do this step. Okay? So far,
Okay.
so good?
Yep.
Great. So let's go, come back
Do
here.
you want us to do the same thing that you are doing at the same time?
Yeah, you can. You can do this as I'm doing, like on flight. You can do anyway, but I would suggest like just see me doing. And since we have like the recorded session, try to do this by yourself. Try to run the course by yourself. And oh, if you have like any question, come back to the recorded and see there. And because if you try to do this, I mean, I don't know. I'm not a multitasking person. I try to be, but I always get like very confused about. But I mean, there is nothing that impede you to do this. I would just suggest like to create a new folder here. So you create a new folder for you. I mean, with your name, and copy the notebook file to your folder and run there. Because if you run this in here in this folder, you have like two persons in one instance. And it might be some conflicts and some
Yep.
funny thing can happen. So if you want to do this, what I'm doing, just like create a folder for you, copy the Jupyter notebook, put it there and run on your folder. That
Yeah,
is.
no, I think I'll be mostly listening now and do that myself
Oh,
later.
okay. But I would suggest like to do the same, like because you can. Let me open here. You can. On your Google Colab, you can see here, you can add some comments that's like, oh, this cell doesn't run, this cell is not working for me. And I can go there on the comment and try to answer you, try to debug with you
All
the
right.
problem as well. Let me see. Let me just grab a little bit of water and I come back like really quickly. I'm just like,
Sure.
I forgot to do this. Okay. I'm back. Oh, I speak. too much. So, first things first, I mean, why we are going to do this? Why we are going to do these lectures and doing this? This is like, from my side, I decided to give these lectures because we are always getting students, and the students, like, you saw at the morning how enthusiastic, like, Roma and the Antonio is with machine learning. They are, like, all of doing this. And I kind of have like to give this lecture for every student that is coming. So I just like, okay, if we are going to make these kind of things formal, so let's try to grab all of the students together so I can give to everyone at once. And in the next semester, we'll do the same, like we're going to do this. And why we are going to use PyTorch? PyTorch because I really, really like it, but we could use TensorFlow if you wish, or JAX. I also use JAX, and but I prefer to do PyTorch because it's like it's more easy to, at least that I feel that I'm by experience, the students are like learn a little bit more faster with PyTorch, mostly because of FastAI, which is an API that it can build all of this neat stuff in machine learning almost automatically for you, without like put any effort or anything like this. But I prefer to at least teach the basics of PyTorch because the students can go to the FastAI and modify the things that they need, because FastAI is really, really good, but it has some limitations. But if you know a little bit of PyTorch, you can modify quite good. I mean, you can really modify the FastAI for your proposal. And you can always come back or build your entire system on PyTorch, which is relatively easy. It's not like that very difficult. I know that you guys have like some experience with programming language like Python and C++. I have like this, and this is really good because I don't have like to teach like the basics of computing anything like this. But the purpose of this lecture is to be like this, it'll be like more data driven, more like this. I will build like the models, I will try to do this. And during that we're building the models, like really hands-on doing this, we're going like to explain some details, some theoretical details about the tools that we're going to need, like how we are using, why we are using this convolution, why we are using batch norm, all of this kind of thing. Because these are like these are really good. They have like a really strong theoretical motivations. We can explore this as well, but I prefer to like do this while we are doing the code. I don't know if it's the most efficient way, but for me, it's the way that like I learn the most like this. So we still don't have any. I'm writing. I'm still writing the formal plans that I have in mind, but it will be like this. It will be like we are going to learn how to build data loaders, data set, all of this basic stuff. But we are going to explore mostly the computer vision problem. So what it means like we are going to build the classification models based on images like this. That's why computer vision. And these models will be like, the first will be like a binary classification. You have like two classes and you want to separate between these two classes. Not doesn't necessary to be two classes, but like if a given image is true or not belongs to one specific class. This is just like the way that binary classification works. After binary classification, we're going to work with what is called a multi-label, multi-class, enfim. What is meant is like for a given example, for a given sample, you might have examples of that sample which can be like multiple classes. Like you give a dashboard car photo and you have like other cars, buses, people, bicycles, all of this. These are a clear example of a multi-label, multi-class. Later we're going to expand this and we're going to look for object detections, which is like this, that bounded boxes stuff. That's like, let's see, object detection. Detection. Yeah, you see like TensorFlow, PyTorch, is like this. So, We are going to explore this kind of models as well. And this is like a multi-label, multi-class object detection. This is just like the higher order model like this. And if everyone survived, at some point I will try to measure all the students like this. We are going to explore a little bit about deep generative models, which is like variation autoencoders, GANs, and all of these. Not this one. Yeah.
This is what you was doing in Japan.
What I was doing, what?
You were in China, right? Working on machine learning.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. This is like the main bread and butter that is like my research like this. I do like a lot. So the it would be like this, like a binary classification, multi-label, multi-class, the later object detection. In object detection as well, we are going to explore image segmentation, which is really, really interesting, like this. Image segmentation. Okay, like the build like this kind of a masks, images masks, that like these models are really, really cool, really neat, like this. And after this, we are going to explore, if you have like some time and people have like some curiosity, we are going to explore like this generative adversarial network and variation autoencoders stuff as well, which is really, really interesting to do this. So, to beginning, I mean, any question so far? By the way, I also like to write the program, the steps, and some literature, so you can go there and you can check, and you can also like check if I'm talking some bullshit or anything like this. So you can just like, aha, busted. you are not doing your right job. So I'll give like some really, really good books. I think I give like to Vasilius some of these books, which will be based, the lectures will be based on these books, and we can discuss this as well. And you can also study by yourself. Okay.
I have the Fast AI book. It was very useful.
Yeah. So we are going to expand a little bit more on the Fast AI as well. So I'm going to. Any questions so far? Okay. So.
And we build a model that creates the couplings we need to pass all the observables.
I mean, for this it will be a different kind of a machine learning model. For this it will be like not computer vision, but we can use the same kind of a framework, the same kind of thing. For this it will be a simple model. It will be like even more simple. This stuff that we're going to explore here, like a quite quite advanced, but it's not like it is useless for what we're intending to use. Like for that one, we can use the same machine learning machinery, yes, the same kind of a thing, but we just needed to change the type of the data, just like this. And yes, that's the beauty of these things. I mean, we are going to learn on computer vision application, which is really, really neat. I mean, I don't know if you, but if you would like to go look for jobs as well, you see like computer vision jobs. Yeah, you see it's like let's see in the Google jobs. Careers, yeah, Google research. So, yeah, I mean, if you look for machine learning jobs application in the computer vision, it you'll be like, you see, it has a lot of like open positions, and it's not like it's a really, really good skill set to have. I'm trying to say this like this, and you also like going to explore a little bit more on this, on how we can use computer vision to classify some data points that we have as well, and for beyond the standard model physics or anything like this related. Okay, if you go, okay, so I think that's everything I have to say for the introduction. Any question? Anything? Any comments? Complaints? I mean, feel free to interrupt me at any time. Okay. Since we start a little bit delayed, and we are going to extend on this. So, in the Google Drive, you find like these two Jupyter notebooks first. Okay. I'm going like to go very quickly on this notebook called Tensors, because PyTorch uses these tensors. PyTorch, like all the calculations from the machine learning side, for the machine learning thing that we're going to use, they are made using tensors. Tensors is just like a fancy multi-dimensional array, just like this. It is people from computing science also like to grab these physics notations and all of this kind of mathematical and physics notation like this. To run the Jupyter notebooks like this on the Google Colab, I mean, I'm running here, I'm just like, but I didn't take a little bit of care. To run this, you have like to go on your session. Here is in Portuguese, mine is in Portuguese, but I think that's yours in English. You go to, I don't know what is the name in English, that's like, you say execution environment, I think it is. You go on the...
Isn't it kernel?
Yes, kernel? Okay.
I think so.
Yeah. You go on the tab that has like kernel or environment execution, or I don't know what it is, and you go like change the kernel type or change the execution type like this. You have like to look for this option. And you'll be faced like with three types of options. You have like none. So the none, it will be like all your executions will be only made on CPU, which is good but not fast. We are interested in do things fast, and for to do things fast, you have to execute the things on GPUs or TPUs. GPUs are like the graphic process unit. It's just like this. Fortunately, deep learning stuff run really, really well on computer graphic cards, like on GPUs, because of the type of operations that this computer graphic cards manage is kind of like the same type of operations that the deep learning does. So that's like a really, really intersection, interlap of fields, like the gaming, the research unit is being a lot benefited by the gaming community because of these kind of cards. And you have also the option for these TPUs. These TPUs, these are called like Tensor Process Unit. These are like from Google. They are pushing this a lot. These are like kind of like a GPU, but more tailored for these tensor calculations. And they are like a little bit more faster thing. But PyTorch has support for TPUs, but you have like to be a little bit mindful for some operations, but we are not going to touch TPU today. We are going only use GPUs. You click on GPUs and you just like click save. My case is salvar. So have you managed to change this?
Well, I mean, as I said, I think I'm going to be doing this later on, like, rewatch the thing. But
okay.
I mean, so far I'm following. This is all straightforward.
Okay.
I think it is restart kernel or something like that.
Yes, here you're going to restart and you're going like to associate it. Like your, once you're doing this, it will be instantiate a session from the Google, and you have like a free GPU to train someone. Of course, it's not like a NVIDIA 3090 or something like this. I mean, it can be if you can pay, but this one are free. So you are going to use, you have like some limitation, but you can still run the codes, you can still run the thing. So I will, to run the cells, it's just like a shift enter, and you just like execute the cells, or just like click here on this play button, like this. And this is like to check if is like this cell is for me to check if it is, I have GPU option. I have like the GPU acceleration. This is just like, okay, check if it has CUDA. CUDA is from the NVIDIA, is like the library to do GPU acceleration. And check if it has some CUDA something. So if you return true, so we have a GPU and we are able to do this. And we can start like to play with these torch tensors like this. So what is this? This is just like a container and a data type that we can use, that is used by torch to make the operations. Like all of this fancy stuff, all of these things is based on this kind of a container like this. And we can build a scalar, a tensor of rank 0. A rank 0 tensor is a scalar. You just give like a, you just have like to give this option here, like for the torch random. I'm just like a create a random scalar with one random scalar. You just create like this. So this is like a tensor of rank 0, like this. And I mean, when you run, it will be like a different value because I'm taking like a random number every time. Or you can create tensors with rank 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, depend on the set that you want. You just like give to do this. This is like a vector that we have like a tensor of rank 1, like this. And this is a tensor of rank 2, is just a matrix. You can create this. And this is a tensor of rank 3. This is like more interesting because most of the time when we are dealing with computer vision, we are dealing with images, and in images we have like a height and width, we have like this, and the color dimension. We have like three colors, or if you have like a satellite images, you can have like a 7, 12 colors. It's not like colors, but like different kinds of the spectrum you can store on different channels, like this. And you have like this kind of operation, like this kind of like a tensor, like this. So we can also create tensors from lists. Like we can create, we can pass a list or arrays as well. We can create tensor from NumPy arrays. It has a function. It has like this function here. I think that I put. The function to create a tensor from NumPy arrays is just like this. It's just like a torch dot from NumPy. Ah, and yes, another thing that I forgot like to mention, like because in the Jupyter Colab, it has these really neat options that it can give all the documentations and the things that you need like to use like this. If I run on a local machine, you just need like to press tab or shift tab, depending on the case, like to have the documentation, or you just can do this kind of a thing. When you do this, it automatically appears like here, in the case of the Jupyter, the doc stream documentation and even like some examples like I have like this. So which is really good, like if I'm going to do some code and have like some difficulties or can remember the parameters of a function, you just like type this and you can get the immediate help, like, or you can also get like you can also do this kind of a thing like tensor. Oh, it's invalid. Okay. I will not take much time. I forgot like this. You can do this like a dir torch. So when you do this, so it will give all the options that you have, like from this class, like from, you can create like a pair chain. This is a, these are all functions that belong for this torch class, like this, and you can like call one of them, like torch.pol in that case, and you can call the question mark, so it will give you the help. This is like the main way that when I'm doing some code, when I'm doing something, like to try to check if the things are right, if the things that I'm importing make sense, and try like to look for the documentation. The other thing that I look for help is Stack Overflow, which is open here, and you go there, and you know, Stack Overflow, put the error, put the thing, and try to see from if you can get like some answers like this. So here we can create the from a list. I'm passing a list of lists, and when I pass by this way, the torch.tensor function from the class, it automatically converted this into a tensor. It automatically build this in my matrix, in my Hankey tree tensor, like this. You can also check like the dimensions from this. You can, let me see here, x dot, if you put like this way, okay, it will give you like the dimensions of the tensor in that case. Or you can check the shape of the tensor as well, and you have like this, it will give like the shape of the test that you create. You can also can count like the number of elements, like that's why the name like numelk, number of elements, and you can give it, will give you like, it will return you the number of elements. This is, these things will be very very useful when you want to like to check how much memory the dataset is occupying on the model that I'm going to train in. How can we like reduce the size of the data set, the number of elements, all of these kind of like of functions that we have. And we can also get the numbers, like get the elements of a tensor using the indexation scheme, like here. I'm asking for like the indexation in Python start like from zero and go like to infinity or minus one that you want, and you ask, okay, I want like from the, because we have like the shape, let me see here, we have a 3x3 shape. I'm asking from the first line, from the zero line, the second element, I mean first line and the second is column, like this. So I'm saying that's like, okay, this element here, it will be changed from 0 to 5 when I do this. So I just like change it here from 0 to 5 like this. We can use it like this kind of indexations in any channel. We can use it like this way, or we can also use it like this way here. So we can also use as this 0 and 1. We can call this indexation as well. We can also use like this kind of like a constructor. That's like, we have like torch zeros, torch ones. We just have like to pass the dimension, like the size of the vector of the tensor that you want to reach. Like here, I built like a 2x2 matrix filled with zeros, but we can pass like a 2x3 in that case, or 5x8 in that case. So we can create like this kind of like empty matrices like this. We also have like instead of using zeros, let's say I want to create a diagonal matrix, like with all of the off diagonals of the main principal diagonal 0 and the one like it to be 1. So to do this, we just like use this torch dot I, and you have like to pass the dimension. The matrix will be always a square, it will always be like a square matrix. You just like pass, so it will create a 4x4 diagonal matrix, so or 10x10, like this. I use this a lot to do this like one hot encoding, like this. And in one of the feature data sets that I'm going to manipulate, I'm going to use this as well. I'm going to use this kind of like a matrix manipulation. It has other constructors that we have, but I'm not going like to extend a little more on this kind of thing. So we also have like this torch ones. It's like instead of like filling with zeros, it will fill with ones that we have. And we can perform operations with this, like adding matrices, multiplying, do all of these element-wise operations with these tensors as well, which is really, really neat. And it's basically what this deep learning stuff is doing. Okay? So I think, yes, we can also like moving from one place to another. When you create a tensor, all the tensor that you create, like everything that you are creating, they are like by default created on the CPU. So they create like with the term like a CPU. If I check here, so let's see, x dot see device. We have all of the tensor that has like this. And it will give you like the kind of where your tensors reside. So this will be very important for when you're going to create models and the data loaders and everything. Because let's say you create your data set and you say your data set is stored on the CPU and your machine learning model is in your GPU. They cannot communicate. You have like to move all your model to the CPU or your data set to the GPU. You have like to do both of the things. You have like two tensors. Both of the tensors has to reside on the same device, on the same thing. So in order to do this, in order to move from and to CPU and GPU, you have like this option, like a two, like this. This is just like is also a cast operation option. This is just like, okay, you created this tensor here and you're moving this tensor from the CPU to the GPU, like this. So here I create like the CPU tensor, and now I'm creating like a new tensor that I'm copying the CPU. However, we are going to move to the GPU. And once you're doing this, this is basically the stuff that they have to do on the to move in the data set to the GPU. And once he got like here, you see, and now it said that's like in the CUDA device. The CUDA device means that it's like its own GPU. Another thing is like if you are fancy and you have like more than one GPU on your computer, it will also say like which GPU is reside. Like if you have like multiple GPUs, it will store it can be stored in different of these GPUs. Like it can be like from GPU 1, GPU 2, GPU 3, and it also has like the same rule. The two tensors has to be on the same GPU as well. If you have one tensor on a GPU and the other tensor in another GPU, they cannot like do the operation. Have like to be mindful about this. Okay, so far so good.
Yes,
I mean this part is really, really tedious. I mean, it's really boring.
Is this moving between CPU and GPU, like switching the type of the tensor, is that computationally expensive?
No. I mean, when you go from CPU to GPU, it's a little bit expensive. It's a little bit like this. You have like to moving data, I mean, moving data in any part of the computer is expensive. It have like some costs, it have like this. But once you are like inside of the GPU, inside of like the especially when you are going like the operation inside of the GPU, the operation is like is extremely cheap. Like is really fast to do this. The only problem is like after you do this, you have to come back to the CPU. And this is in fact computational. It's not like very expensive. It will be more expensive if you have like everything happens inside the CPU, right? This is like really expensive. But once you like take the data, move to the GPU, do the operations, is almost free, like free of charge. But
Okay.
once you have done the operation, like you have your model and you train the model, we have like all of this. But you want to do inference, you want to do the test of the model, everything. You have like to move your model to the CPU and do the inference on the CPU. But the most expensive part is the training. And the training on the GPU side, it's inside the GPU is almost free. Almost. So we have this, and I think that's like you can go on the Jupyter Notebook and you can check all this operation, have like this max operation that's like we are going to use a lot to validate models and everything, get the predictions on this. You have like the cast operation as well, because you use the tool not only to move the data between CPU and GPU, but also to perform this casting operation. The casting is like you create a tensor with one data type. You create a tensor with like here that we have like this is a integer type. Like this is like a long tensor, that's called. But you want to convert this to a float. But how do you do this? Use this the same tool operation. When you do this, I mean, I'm converting this from the long to a float 32, like this. And you convert the tensor to a float. You convert like this. You can also convert like to. There are other operations like uint. Yes. It has the uint operation, like this. You can also do this conversion. It will be like a byte tensor. You can try to play around with this kind of this. These are really interesting. Like Ludovic created like a really neat program but he did in Java, like this. And at one point he has some issues with processing and some memory management like this. And I said like, okay, you don't need to use float 32 every time. You can use like float 16 or other data type like this. And you can change inside, like not only in Java, but you can also change this on the PyTorch. You have like float 32 in the and yes, you have like half a tensor or float 64, double tensor. You have like this. You can always play with the data types using the tool function as well. Okay. And we can also have like this in place operations that I'm this. The in place operations, that's like the operation that take a part on the tensor itself, like this. So what I'm trying to say is like, okay, let's create this random tensor here and see. And let's say I give some put some operation on the tensor, right? If I do this, it create like the log of this input tensor. However, if I call the tensor again, so like let's call it the random tensor again, you see it is like it comes to the natural state. I didn't change the tensor. I just like take the tensor, give the operation, and give like the output like this. However, if I do the operation in place. In place, it means like when you have like this underscore, after the function, like you have this, and this will change my tensor permanently. This is like modify this, and if I call it again, you see it remains. Like this operation, have like to be really mindful about this, because you can do this. I mean, you can save a lot of memory, but you have like to make sure that you are not going to use the same tensor again in other part of the model. Because if the other part has like other funny thing that depends on the original tensor, you will modify that as well. You have like to be really, really careful. These operations, like these in-place operations, they save a lot of memory, but also have like to be very, very careful about how you can use and when you can use it, this kind of operation, like this. And you can reshape as well. You can create like these tensors. And modify for the purpose that you want, like this. The here we have like a 784 vector, like this, and I converted this vector into a 28 by 28 by 1 channel image, like this. I can do all of this conversion like this. And if you don't want to care about the dimensions or anything like this, you can just put like a -1 like this, and when you indicate like this -1, you say like, okay, convert everything like this. Let's say here, do the operation, but figure out what is this second dimension here. Try to do this, and when you do this, so it will automatically compute for you. But you can only do this with one dimension. You cannot do like with three dimensions, like like do this. Be, of course, because it's like it's a mathematical principle. You have like to do this kind of like operation, and you don't it will not solve the state equation to do the reshape for you.
Like, I have a question.
Yes.
If you try to reshape like that with a minus one.
Yeah.
And then the other number. So there you had you had the flat tensor with 784 elements, right?
Yes.
And then you try to reshape it so that it's 2 times something times 28.
Yeah.
Wait, I'm just trying to figure out if there can be a situation where.
No, you always.
That won't have a solution.
Yes, you always have to take it to account, like the product of the dimensions cannot be bigger than the original dimensions, like this. You could have
exactly. So what if it mismatches? What if
it will give you an error? It will give like let's see. See, it will like invalid the input for this. But you can. I mean, you cannot like put a -1 or -1. But you, let's see if you can put like a 7. No, 1 here. Yeah. And
okay. So basically, there must be a solution for the equation that
yes.
2 × 1 × 28 × something actually.
Yeah, it can. Yeah, you can always have like mind for that. Like this product doesn't, it cannot be higher than the original one, like this. Actually, he does this solution by using this dimension coordinate like this.
So it has to exactly match the number of elements.
Yes, exactly.
Okay, thanks.
These operations are really, really like this is called like view operations. So these view operations, you are not modifying the flat tensor set, okay? You are just like viewing the flat tensor. You see the flat tensor remain the same original one. We are just like take this and make a view of the tensor, like you are doing this kind of, that's the name view, like this. We are not changing anything on the original tensor. We just like take here and view in a new dimension like this.
Right, but we create a new tensor, right?
Yes, we automatically create a new tensor called the viewed tensor.
And that one has a new dimensionality.
Yes, exactly.
Yes.
Like this. So this is a two operations happen at once. The first operation is a clone operation. We are cloning this tensor here, we are copying here, this. And the second one, we are reshaping the operation. So the view has like two at the price of one, like this. You can also use like a reshape as well, but it's the same kind of a thing, it's the same operation. But you have like to be mindful because like the view in like I explain like the view in the reshape, they change the original dimension like this. So that's all the behind the scenes. So in general, I recommend using reshape rather than view like this. So another thing is yes, the permutation. The permutation is really useful for operation because in PyTorch, what is happening? PyTorch, the models on machine learning PyTorch, they accept like the dimension will be like this for the computer vision. It'll be like first channel, high and width, like this. And in TensorFlow, it is high, width and channel. Like this is like this one. And most of the case when I'm going to look for images, it will be have like this. It will have like a high, width and channel like this. So you have like to be mindful and swap this. To swap, use the permutation operation like this. See, here it will be let's suppose I have like a 640 by 480 pixels images with three colors. Let's suppose we have like this image. But I want to feed this into a model in PyTorch. So I have like to swap this. I want like this dimension here. I want to be at the first, like the channel, and the others remain like this. How can I do this? I use this permute function, and in this permute function, the arguments you have to put the indexes of the dimensions like this. So size it indexed by zero, so we have like dimension zero, dimension one, and dimension two. I want this to be the first, so I put like two here, zero will remain, and one will remain to be like. So when I do this, now the tensor has like the correct shape that I need. This operation we are going to do a lot on the data loaders and data set. However, because people already know a lot about this pane right now, it has like some functions on the PyTorch that it does this automatically for you. You don't need like not even to thinking about. So you just like call the function and the function make all of these changes and everything like for you. You don't need like to be careful about. And for this. This operation of broadcast, I'm just like a glance over, but this last one, it's really interesting and I really like and I wish people use it more, is the Einstein summation. Have you ever guys saw this or anything? I mean, we saw this on physics.
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah, but this also has like a PyTorch has this really neat thing, this Einstein summation, that we can use this as well. And the thing is, we can pass the equation for the summation as these strings, as this kind of thing. For me, when you do any kind of mathematical operation with a string, is a kind of like a black magic. I don't know about you, but I never feel comfortable about this. But it is really powerful. It's really interesting because we can do this kind of okay. You want to create like you want to compute the trace of some matrix, some n by n matrix like this. You just pass like okay, it will be compute on the index I and the index I, which is mean the diagonal, and you give the tensor. So I put here the tensor is like a 4 by 4 tensors of ones like this. And it calculated the trace automatically. You can do this like instant in a second. And you can even do this in GPU, in the GPU part. So let's see, you want like a 14 by 14. So it computed the trace. Okay, not that one, but I want a random. So, okay. It gives you. So. And this is just like a small example. You can build like a really wacky operations on this. So here it computes the, it extracted the diagonal of the matrix. You just like, okay, take the diagonal and just like give me the index. You just need to pass this string. You just need to pass this and the tensor itself. You can make some like outer product and the inner product as well. You can do this kind of like a calculations. So you just like, okay, take the column and take the line and take the column and do the operations. It will be construct a new tensor and you just pass these two tensors for them like this. So I don't know about you, but this kind of things, like you build the operation on the string and say like this, and the machine computer, this is kind of thing that's like, what? I mean, what is happening here? What, like, you can do batch multiplications, you can like take the matrices and multiply in batch. And these are really useful that I'm using a lot, because you can take all of the data sets that will be matrices, that will be like these tensors that are all of these, on the GPU. You can multiply all the batches, you can compute means, you can compute the special, you can do everything that you want using these strings, using this kind of operation strings. And it will do this in a second, like in a fraction of a second, like this. And I was wondering if one day, I mean, I could like prepare like a general relativity using PyTorch and and this kind of operation. So I think for today we take like a little bit of time of this, but this kind of, I hope that I give you some sense that using this PyTorch, it can be a really, really useful thing. For today, we didn't touch anything for deep learning. We're just like using the basics, getting around and work with Jupyter notebook and the collaboratory thing. Feel free to go to the second notebook, like tensors. I repeat a little bit on this, but this will have like a more useful stuff, because here you build like a data loader, a data set, a data loader, and load it to the into the machine, split it to training and training validation, even build like the machine learning model, like the convolutional model, like to this, and do some operation. But this will be like for the next session. For today, I mean, we can end here, like this. But I wish like you guys like go to this notebook, run the cells, modify, play around, and put like some operations. Come with a new operation from the Einstein soon that you feel that's like, yeah, this could be really cool. And at least test, play around with this. On the next session, we are going like to start to build the machine learning, the proper machine learning stuff. Okay.
Sure. Should I stop recording?
Yeah. We can end it for today. I mean, it's
recording stopped.
It's 1 hour, like we have. And if you have any question, if you cannot like run the cells or have like some bug or something, feel free to come here on the cell and add a comment like this. Let's see.
Right.
Couldn't not run. So I can go there and we can try to debug.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
When is the? Are we going to do this every Friday or every second Friday or
every second Friday?
Every second Friday. Okay.
Yeah.
Cool.
Okay.
Yep.
And yes, that's it. And you can always like contact me on Skype. If I not reply right back, I will reply at some point, and we can try to do this. Okay.
Yep. Yep.
I hope you guys like it. I think that's
yeah.
I will stop here. Okay. So, anything else?
No, I don't have any questions right now.
No, me neither.
So, I will stop recording here. Let's see.